This video is sponsored by DiamondFire. I'm Legitimoose, and you're watching DiamondFire. DiamondFire, for those of you who don't know, is a Minecraft server, for those of you who are unaware, that lets you code your own minigames using a robust suite of completely in-game coding tools. Semicolons be gone, blocks and items are the new hot syntax. When you first log on to DiamondFire, you'll be greeted by the tutorial. Hallelujah! If you follow it, it will take you through claiming a plot, placing your first code block, giving players an item, and detecting when a player right-clicks with that item. Great! That just about answers any questions you might have had about DiamondFire. See ya! Actually, how do I get those giant glass code lines everyone has? What do all these different blocks do? What's this stuff on the side? Sorry if I'm being annoying, but what's my first name? In this video, I'll answer all that and more. Stick around and subscribe to help me remember my first name. Okay. Here we are on an empty basic plot, right after finishing the tutorial. Before we continue, let's stop coding on the ground like animals. You can add these glass lines with the command /plot:\c\l. The dash L makes your code space into lines instead of a big pancake, and the dash C makes it compact, so it's closer to the previous layer than it would otherwise be. I'd personally recommend creating a bunch of layers right at the start so you don't forget the command later and end up with a random pancake right in the middle of your beautiful glass lines. What do all these different blocks do? More like, what don't they do? So, first, you've got your player event and its lamer twin, entity event. These are the only two event blocks, which means they're the only blocks that get called directly from the game. Then you've got your actions. Player action, entity action, and game action. Player slash entity action is for doing things to players slash entities, and game action is for doing things that aren't specifically related to making players or entities do stuff, except spawning entities. You've also got if player, if entity, and if game. If player and entity being self-explanatory, and if game having a selection of oddly specific, yet very useful things to check out. There's also if variable and else. If variable is a powerhouse. You're gonna be seeing a lot of this one. Then you've got your functions and your processes. Don't overuse processes, and don't underuse functions. Seriously, the best thing you can do for organization is to make functions for everything. And name them sense-makingly. The last code blocks are one-offs. Repeat is just a for loop, and if you don't know what that is, you don't need to worry about it. Control is usually used for time delays, like wait 1 second. And select object is usually not used, because you can shift right-click actions to do the same thing. What's this stuff on the side? What, you mean the reference book, not arrow, and values ingot? These are my best friends in the world. Except you, not arrow. Useless stick looking. The values ingot contains all the types of variables. I originally wrote this much about variables, but my spiritual advisor says that if I read that whole thing aloud, I'll cast a curse on my family. Basically, all it says is that game values like this aren't used very often and can safely be ignored. Ah! Fake moose! Fake moose! Variables are everything! The earth is a variable! Your soul is a game value! Read the reference book! It's all there! The truth is waiting! Variables are-
I still don't remember my name.
Great! That should leave absolutely nothing unresolved. Now let's hop on to mcdiamondfire.com and search for inspiration for our next game. First, you should check out my game, so I can get those sweet, sweet creator points. In my game, you play as a human in a world of floppy mooses. The floppy moose life is a happy one, but after a stiff moose uprising in the area, nearly all the floppy mooses have been stiffened. Fortunately, at the center, there's a floppy moose shrine. You must bring a moose with you to collect stiff mooses and floppify them in the water. After that, you can bring them on your journey. You are human, and thus immune to stiffness, but the moose you carry on your head is not. Each moose only has so much stamina before you and your moose have to be warped back to safety. There are safe zones, deadly plants, and over 2 mooses for you to... discover. Legend has it that the moose statue at the center of the shrine used to be a floppy moose god. He absorbs all the stiffness in the area and is now one of the stiffest mooses of all time. You can join and explore my game right now by typing /join50136 on mcdiamondfire.com. Some of my other favorite games are Block TD by Sputt, which I've probably logged over 12 hours in at this point. I may have also stolen the central concept of my game from here. Whoops! Dashing Playground by Korespond, just a really solid and fun grappling hook mechanic. The Caverns by sludsVEVO is a brutally slow-paced mining game that makes up for the grind with the polished look and feel of every little thing. Speaking of polish, I was super impressed by Northtorn. It's a pretty basic Don't Starve-like survival game, but the effects in it blew me away. So what are you waiting for? Go join mcdiamondfire.com. Play my game. Play everyone's game. You might even run into me there. Don't forget to like and subscribe and all that. Oh, and I remembered my first name. It's Bgobgubgliogubble. Thanks for watching, and thanks for 12,000 subscribers. So see you in the next one. Thanks, lads.